It's great seeing all of you here. For those of you who don't know myself, again, my name is Ike, and it's an absolute pleasure to be speaking with all of you this afternoon, all right? Now, as you know, today we have a very special guest visiting the Conservatory today, and he's graciously taken time out of his busy schedule to come speak with us and share his insights and experiences for the next couple of hours. Now, for those of you who are unfamiliar, our guest is what we would definitely call a heavy hitter in the industry. A five-time Grammy winner, Manny is one of the most successful, influential, and in-demand mix engineers today. His discography is a massive statement containing a wide diversity of a variety of A-list clientele, and his skills and expertise have influenced the recordings of John Mayer, Tupac, Whitney Houston, Katy Perry, Taylor Swift, Justin Bieber, Maroon 5, Bruno Mars, Alicia Keys, Mariah Carey, Usher, Jay-Z, Rihanna, Kanye West. I mean, the list goes on and on. Manny's body of work and the work that he's contributed to is immense. And it's not only influenced our industry, but really music history as a whole. So let's welcome for the first time at the Conservatory of Recording Arts and Sciences, Manny Marroquin.
Thank you.
Please have a seat.
Wow, what a great group. Woo. How y'all doing today? Good. I'm excited to be here. Thank you for having me. This is I enjoy talking to guys like yourselves and ready to embark in this exciting world of audio. So congrats to you guys for making that move, and good luck, and I hope we these next 2 hours, whatever you guys want to ask me, I'm here for you guys, and I hope to share as much information as we have time for. And so any question, boxers, briefs, anything. You know,
right? All right. Thank you so much, Manny. And before we begin, I just wanted to say on behalf of myself, the entire student sector of the AES, and the whole conservatory community, thank you again so much for coming here. It's truly an honor, and we really love having you.
My pleasure, thanks.
Alrighty, now since a large portion of the demographic of, you know, the audience out here are students that recently decided to pursue, gain, and hopefully maintain a career in the audio industry, I think that a lot of that decision for many of us stems from just a passion for music and sound, either early in life from studying music or film or TV or anywhere where sound is a facet. So I wanted to open off this discussion by asking you first, how did your interest in music and by effect audio begin? I mean, before even you considered it or even knew it was a career, how did that start for you?
Well, you know, it started, I think we all here have a passion for music, right? I mean, just raise your hands if you enjoy listening to music. 95%. So we have, you gotta understand that to be successful at this, you gotta be passionate. One thing they don't teach you in school, they don't teach you passion. How do you teach passion? I think I discovered it at some point where I started playing drums. So I'm a drummer. And then I felt really connected to musicians. Every time we did a gig together, there was just this really cool connection with every single one of everyone I played with. I went to a music high school, sort of like Fame. I don't know if you guys remember that show. You may be too young, but I saw a drummer there audition right before me, and his name is Abe Laborio. I don't know if you guys know Abe Laborio, but he plays with Paul McCartney. He's probably one of the baddest dudes alive. Right there, I quit playing drums. I quit because I thought I will never be this good, and I'm gonna shift my focus to something else. At that time, they had the school Hamilton Music Academy had a small production room, and they had a synth track. And we had a little MIDI studio. And we had a reel-to-reel, 8-track reel-to-reel, and a 24-channel RAM subboard. And that's the first moment I discovered the art of sound. So what we would do is we would produce a song on Monday through Thursday, and then Friday we had to present it to the class. on Thursday, we had to record it and do a little rough mix. And we all had to play everything. We had, you know, we had to play all the parts. When it came time to mixing, doing a rough mix, it was really interesting for me to discover that you have so much control over emotions of frequencies and sounds. And I didn't understand that because it's not, I'm not playing a chord. I mean, everything's been recorded, but the fact that I can add aggression with compression, aggression with EQing, with levels, simple level changes, and how I discovered that the emotion changed when I had the different levels. And that was really powerful. That was like, oh shit, you can actually do this. I didn't know it existed. And that's when it started. Not, you know, I must have been like 16 at the time. And from there, you know, like you guys, I lived it, breathed. I mean, it was 24 hours a day. It was just listening to music and trying to record it, trying to sort of do rough mixes, trying to play. My whole life was based around music. So for you guys, how many of you guys play instruments here? Raise your hands. Okay. So for you that didn't raise your hands, it's never too late. It's not like you have to master something. Just pick something up, you know, and understand just basic music theory, you know, basic chord changes, basic arrangement. And you should do that. You should start now, before, you know. So that's when it started. You know, I was in high school, and I've been passionate ever since. And more passionate today than I was back then, believe it or not. So.
Yeah, and I think that you know, in the mixing process, just having that creative element of, again, after everything being recorded, you have an effect on how the emotional, you know, perception of that piece is, you know, it gets pervaded to the audience. It's definitely a powerful thing.
It's an art form for sure.
Oh, absolutely, absolutely. I wanted to ask you next here, being so, you know, inspired by that studio that you had at the, you know, the Hamilton Art Institute and everything. What artists or records influenced you early on? What were some of the anything that stands out?
Yeah, I grew up in L.A. and all my friends, we all listened to hip hop, rap at the time, but all my musician friends, we all listen to Led Zeppelin and stuff like that. So I gotta say, I listened to it all. You know, I know that sounds a little corny, but you know, the first piece of advice for everyone in the room is you cannot discriminate with music, period. So if you're closed-minded, I hate country music, I hate hip hop, I hate rap, all I hear is boom, 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 I hate rock, all I hear is that's closing your mind, and your ego's getting in the way, and that's not good for our industry. We got to be really open-minded. You guys got to really appreciate it, and you'll learn more stuff from the stuff you hate as much as you do from the stuff you love. And just remember, not only do we have to be really passionate about what we're doing, but we got to be open-minded, because if you're closed-minded, the guy sitting next to you that's a little more open-minded will go right past you. And you're not gonna even realize he went right past you. So don't discriminate. Listen to all kinds of genres. Go listen to Kind of Blue and study Kind of Blue, even though you'll never work on jazz. Listen to emotional records. Analyze why is it that you feel a certain way when you listen to, you know, Stairway to Heaven or whatever. Analyze it. Listen to stuff that you wouldn't normally listen to. And that's the first assignment when you leave. Listen to something you wouldn't normally listen to, and listen to it on why you like it and why you don't like it. And trust me, you do that every day of your life, for the rest of your lives, you're gonna learn so much just by listening. We forget to listen. We're more about knobs and faders and monitors and Apple D and all that. But we forget that the first, you know, why we got here in the first place is we love music. We enjoy being around creative people. So there's still the creative process. What you guys are going through here is a very technical process, which is necessary. But don't ever forget that it starts with the left or with the right brain, which is the creative side. And that's going to keep the left. You got to keep those in balance. So
great. As you discovered, you know, an interest clearly in music, and as you went through your high school and you started to experiment in the MIDI lab and that small studio that you had there, how did you discover that there was a career in engineering? I know that for many of the people out here, it's relatively recent that they kind of channeled their passion for audio into making the decision to make it their career. What was that transition for you?
I knew I wanted to be a mixer at 16, and I was lucky in that. That I knew really early. But again, it goes back to me wanting to be around music all the time. And knowing that engineering at the time was not as cool as being a producer, but I knew there was an art form that I wanted to explore. And at the time, I knew that jobs existed. So I just went for it. I pursue my dream. You know, it really was a dream because, listen, I'm from Guatemala, a small country in Central America. So I wasn't even born here. So the odds were totally against, you know. But it wasn't impossible. And there was more people that tried to talk me out of it, you know, to be a technician, to do something else. But whatever you want to do, you just got to, if it comes from the heart and if you're willing to work hard at it, we're in a generation of entitlement. Like, a lot of people think that it should be given to you. And let's break that, you know, especially you guys. Let's just break that, and you gotta go and get it. And I tend to curse a lot, and I'm sorry, but go get that motherfucker, you know? Don't settle, you know? It's not gonna come to you. Yeah, go get it, seriously.
Definitely. I mean, passion in your dreams, I mean, that's the best kind of motivation for you. Absolutely.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
So, touching on you know, when you made the decision to you know, have engineering as your career, clearly, you know, that was your passion just early on, and you wanted to pursue that. To my knowledge, you began working at Enterprise as a runner, and you kind of worked your way up the studio, you know, and that whole process. I wanted to ask, considering that to, you know, many outside parties, that's kind of an unconventional career trajectory, if you will, you know, like pursuing the studio life. I wanted to ask, what was that experience like for you? And was that a difficult decision for you to make? I
mean, yeah, listen, nobody wants to be a runner or an intern, but I feel like it just trained me to appreciate, you know, when I became an assistant engineer. I didn't skip any steps, by the way. What I ended up doing is, high school, I went to a similar school like this, not as cool and hip as this one. But after that, I got a job as a runner. Runners, they get the coffee, and interns. Then I went to assisting engineering, and then I went to engineer, and then I went to a mixer. So I didn't skip anything. And I'm very grateful for that because I know every, you know, I know it all. I know the studio life in every aspect of it. And it just helps me, you know, it helps me stay humble. Being humble is very important to me. Because listen, we're not saving lives here. Well, we may be some, but we're not heart surgeons here. It's entertainment. We're having fun. This is incredible. You're paying me to mix your song. You know what? The way I see that is, anytime somebody asks me to mix a song, is I honestly feel like someone's handing me their baby, their newborn, and saying, "Here, I'll be back in 24 hours." That's a pretty big thing for me. So that's why being humble helps you stay focused, so that you appreciate that the guy that brings your baby. Some babies are a little uglier than others, but but you'll appreciate the baby. So and you'll take care of the baby, and that's really important, because if I'm a client, if I'm an artist, producer, or label, I want that person to take care of my baby. And if I can see that person is going to take good care of my baby, I'm going to keep going back to that babysitter. So we're glorified babysitters, yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, it's someone's life's work, you know, that you're dealing with on a daily basis. So, yeah, definitely showing respect and humility towards that. It's definitely just. Since you worked your way up through the hierarchy of the studio, and you know, experience is the one thing you can't get for free, right? As you worked through that, did you have a strategy when you came into the industry, or was it really just like
just? Nope. I wish I had. Well, maybe not. It was just about, you know what, I'm going to work my ass off. I'm going to be better than the guy next to me, and in a very humble way, but I'm going to kick your ass. And And that was my approach. I was gonna be better than anybody else, and that was, I wanted to be the best, and I still want to be the best, but not to be cocky about being, no, I wanted to be the best that I could do. I know it sounds a little corny, but yeah, I just wanted to do the best mixes. I wanted to work with the best artists. I wanted to be, you know, I wanted to have the, you know, I wanted to be diverse in the genres. I didn't want to just do one thing. I wanted to jump from, and I'm lucky enough to jump from an Imagine Dragons to a Kanye West to, you know, to Mayer to the Rolling Stones. And that to me is loving music. It's, so I don't get to just do one genre, you know? So that was a very conscious decision from earlier in my career. And, you know, I remember calling my manager, like thinking, I want to work with this guy, Citizen Cope. He's like, yeah, but you're going to lose money doing that. You know, why would you do that? And I knew that he was going to help my discography because I wanted to do more stuff like Citizen Cope. And it worked. It worked, you know. I didn't make as much money as some of the other projects, but, you know, it helps the brand and the career to, and for me, it was just, you know, personal. I just wanted to work on different genres.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely. So here at the Conservatory, you know, we emphasize technical skill just because by virtue of being an engineering school, you know, we're teaching the fundamentals of a variety of concepts in engineering. But something that really plays a role is, you know, people skills, something that you've clearly developed to, you know, consistently be in demand as an engineer. Overall, I wanted to ask, how do you approach your attitude in this environment?
You know, listen, what's going to get you through the door is a good attitude. You know, I tell my kids, just learn to say thank you and please, and those two words will get you far. When I'm hiring assistant engineers, right, the technical knowledge is important, but it's not everything. You got to be able to be in a room with people you like, and you want to be, listen, I'm in the studio. By the way, if I sound crazy, I've only had 3 hours of sleep. I probably have had 10 hours in the last 5 days because I'm working on a couple albums. But, you know, I'm here with you guys because I feel this is important. But that's just my life. That's normal. Having 3 hours sleep days is fine. I'm cool with that. So if you like sleep, you better, you know, change that. it's important to be a good people person. Because when I'm hiring an assistant, I don't want to be I don't want an asshole in the room with me for 14 hours a day. I don't want someone to tell me his skills, his technicals. I don't want someone to tell me how many records they've mixed or engineered or demos they have. I want a good person in the room. I want a person that shows the passion, the fact that they want to be there and they want to learn and be humble by it and be humble about it. So those are the qualities that I look for. And I guarantee you 99% of my peers will say the same thing. So if your attitude is not right, you're not getting a job. It's just that simple. So knowing that personality trait from now will help you. So if you say, oh yeah, I am kind of an asshole sometimes, now you can work on it.
Gotta recognize the problem, right? So what I wanted to touch upon next was, considering that just the engineering career and the industry as a whole is a very volatile thing, constantly changing, I definitely think that it holds true a little bit that that it's not the most intelligent necessarily or the strongest that survive, but the ones that are most adept to change. I wanted to ask, considering how so many things have changed throughout your career, were there any other days that were there any days that were harder than others? I mean, were you ever at a point where you questioned your career choices?
Of course, yes. It hasn't, you know. Yes, it's a very challenging field. It's you know, there's a lot of challenges, and we have to adapt constantly. And I always say you got to get used to rejection, because you'll have a lot of that. So as long as you know from the get-go, okay, rejection, I can take it two ways. I can be like, oh, fuck you, or you can put the tail between your legs and run. Or you can take it as constructive criticism, which is you put a positive twist on something that's negative. That's the way I approach it. So when I have the bad days, I'm like, I want to learn from the bad days again to, you know, when they say experience and being wiser is learning how you've adapted to those bad mixes or bad days or crappy songs that sometimes we get. So those days actually help you. So again, the theme, turn a negative into a positive, okay? Because you're gonna have a lot of negatives. You're gonna have a lot of, you're gonna hit a lot of brick walls. And I always say this really corny analogy that whatever it takes to get over that wall, whether you go to Home Depot and buy a shovel, whether you go and get a pole, when you go with Jack, it doesn't matter. Point is you gotta get over that wall. And you have to be willing to fight to get over that. So you are gonna have moments where you're gonna feel like, I hate the song, I hate this guy's guts, he's so talentless, I'm way more talented. You're gonna have those days. But you gotta remember, my high school mentor always said, hey, never forget what you were hired to do. Simple. If you remember that, man, you'll get so far. Because if I'm mixing a song and I'm with Kanye and I tell him his production sucks, it's not my job. Or I tell him I don't like the song. My job is not, hey, let's hire Manny to give us his opinion on the song. My job is to mix the shit out of that record. And that's it. I'm not gonna give him production notes, I'm not gonna tell him anything unless he asks me and I genuinely think he wants to know my honest opinion. And so that now the people skills kick in. You know, I think that after you guys graduate, if you go get a psychology degree, it'll help you as much as something like this, because you do have to read people's mind, you gotta read their body language, you gotta know if they had a bad day, if they had a fight with a girlfriend or wife or boyfriend or whatever. Gotta kind of know what mindset they're at that moment. And that's when it becomes difficult for a lot of people. It's art. And the art of dealing with people is probably more than the skills you have as an engineer, mixer, producer, artist. So you gotta be able to have those people skills. And again, the thing that this stuff that you guys already know, my advice is now you have to apply it. If you've made the commitment to come to a school like this, this is part of that curriculum. You gotta work on stuff like that. And if you're a nice guy already, then hey, be a nicer guy. It won't hurt you, so.